All right. Looks like we're rolling here. Happy Mother's Day, May 13th, 2012. Now, even in the midst of a whirlwind of activity, we still have to take time to focus in on truth and keep the momentum going in your life. There is a goal, and there is momentum towards that goal, but it's very subtle. The world will not explain it to you or show it to you or even acknowledge it or admit to it in any way. And just recently, a couple days ago, I was able to deepen the entire situation. And it's quite amazing, really. We can talk about that. We need to talk about that during these times. The teaching has to elevate itself to keep pace with the frantic pace, exponential pace of the world right now. I think what on May 19th, maybe next Saturday or something, can't be Saturday, but Facebook is going to have their IPO, and this is touted as, you know, some very, very important thing, world-changing thing, and it just, the beat goes on. All of this, Facebook, etc., you might call it the world, Facebook, etc., is designed, again, to enhance the forgetfulness of what we are, period. And this enhancement of the forgetfulness of what we are is what everybody is celebrating in this world. Most people are very, very happy to do that. And in other videos, I pointed out the dynamics of why would we be happy to forget what we are, as if what we are is something terrible. No, it's not, just the opposite. But we decided to try and abandon what we were in order to become some prime creator, in order to become greater, the greatest, the prime creator. So we decided to abandon ourselves, but ourself is so completely wonderful that we had to make up a story that it was terrible in order to forget it. You see, if we get a glimpse of what we are, we would say, oh, I don't want to forget that. Are you kidding? That's crazy to forget that. Why would I want to forget that? It's so wonderful. So we've made up stories and myths, etc., of our origins and how terrible our origins have been. Somehow we've made ourselves up from atoms and evolved from into insects and mammals and apes and all these things. We've made these stories up about how what we are has somehow come from very, very obscure and poor origins, so that we don't want to remember what we are. But all of this is our fables, stories that we've told ourselves to justify the forgetfulness. You see, imagine our situation when we wanted to be prime creator, and yet we're flawless and perfect and have infinite riches, and yet we wanted more. We wanted to be greater than everything. And what a problem, huh? Because why would we how could we forget what we are? You see, we had this terrible dilemma. And the mind, you know, being the perfect servant, presents this self-delusion. And we believe that if we remember what we are, we'll be stricken with the utmost despair and grief, as if what we are is something horrible. So we're desperate to become something new, something different. And Facebook, etc., helps us forget what we are, and so we seem to have a lot of gratitude for that. Whereas teachers, real teachers who share truth in this world, are geared towards advising us to remember what we are, because what we are is flawless and perfect, always has been, always will be. Perfectly happy with what we are. We just, on a whim, we decided we wanted more. We wanted to be prime creator, the origin of all, instead of the extension of all. We're an extension of the totality, but we're not the origin of the totality. These are key points. No matter what your other videos you watch, you need to keep this in mind. This basic core explanations, that all of existence is an attempt that we're using to keep us in a state of deep forgetfulness of what we are. And all of this arose, existence, because we, on a whim, we chose to try and be prime creator. These are core teachings that you can use wherever you go, whoever, you know, what teacher you're listening to and paying attention to, getting advice from, being helped by. These core concepts will help you in that, because it'll fit in. You'll realize, yeah, that we don't need to just brush it under the rug. Say, well, we don't know why any of this arose. You know, brush it under the rug. No, I don't need to do that anymore. The teachings are still true. So many teachers are teaching about the overlay, about experiencing non-negation, about experiencing nirvana, untouched, the perfect spaciousness of what we are. Those are all reminders of what we are. That is very true. That's what we need to do, have to do it. So on this busy, busy Mother's Day, as I get ready to go to brunch, taking some time here to share and communicate the essential truths that are vital, so important. Now, I've also spoken about the ego putting us on a guilt trip, which is very, very true. And the ego telling us that somehow we threaten reality. Okay, we threaten it, and we have the capacity to harm it severely. And we're terrified, because let's say we want to return, remember what we are, but we're afraid that maybe we've been able to destroy it or harm it, or we have the capacity to harm reality. As soon as we believe that we can forget what we are, we tell ourselves we have the capacity to destroy what we are. We have to believe we have some power greater than reality, greater than the prime creator. In order to be prime creator, we have to have something more, right? So the ego tells us, in order to scare us away from what we are, from remembering, from remembrance, tells us that we have a power to destroy reality. And we feel this terrible guilt. We have this horrible guilt within us, very deep-seated guilt. And we then worship the ego as an advisor. We call it the ego God. We call it all sorts of grandiose terms. And we listen to what the ego tells us as to how can we avoid destroying reality? How can we avoid harming what is real? Harming life, killing life. How can we avoid it? How can we become better? How can we grow? How can we learn, etc.? And so the ego puts us on this trip. And the first thing the ego does is introduces the notion that there's this learning capacity, and that that there needs to be a journey and a trip, and there's someone who goes on this journey and trip who eventually will learn the secrets of how to not harm reality. And this journeyer is what we call the I, the person, the self, the persona. This is an invention. And what we're looking at as we go about in the world and talk and interact, that's all a fantasy, an invention of the ego. The ego has simply imagined all of this and told us that there's some profound purpose to it, to the person. That the person is engaged in a long odyssey that will eventually lead to freeing us from the guilt. That the person is somehow going to learn how to function in a perfect way, so that what is not threatened. We become non-threatening, and we won't harm anything. But first, we have to spend eons of development and finding how to do this. And so we're literally playing second fiddle to the person, the persona, the I. And giving the I the opportunity to try and develop this capacity, because we feel this deep guilt and this fear, like, oh, we don't want to destroy reality. We're terrified that we might have some capacity to do that. And so we're desperately turned. We ask her advice, say, who can teach us how not to harm reality? And then the ego says, ah, I know the way. And here's the way. You see this interactions here and these qualities and characteristics? Those things need to develop. And there, we call these qualities and characteristics and interactions the person. A person. There is no actual entity or identity or person there at all. There's just all these characteristics and actions and activities that are supposed to be teaching devices that somehow are going to develop a capacity of non-harm that we crave because we're afraid of harmfulness. We have a guilt that we can obstruct, that we can take away, that we can block, that we can prevent experience of true happiness and safety and stability and all of that, that we're guilty of some severe crime. So we pay attention and put ultimate importance in the activity of the world, the person. And yet there is no person there. There is no I. It's just assumed for the sake of paying attention to all this, that there's some core development taking place, a new core. We believe we're guilty of devastating crimes against reality, but there's a new core that is gradually evolving, and this new core will not have these characteristics and traits, and we're kind of purifying things, so to speak. So we're paying attention to this alleged purification process, this growth process, the process of evolvement. We as spirit are literally sitting back and, you know, sweating it out, saying, I hope this new core develops so that I can shift over to that and have a new core, because my previous core was incredibly harmful. I was able to devastate reality. I got to get rid of that. And so we place emphasis on developing this core and assuming that there is a core. Now, the fact is, there is no such core. Nothing's being developed. And in seeing this, one gets insight into what the great teachers have said in the past. Drop the I. Let the personality disintegrate, dissolve. You have no need for it. It's really nothing at all, etc. Well, how do we get rid of the guilt? We get rid of the guilt by choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. We don't need the ego to get rid of guilt. The ego won't get rid of guilt for us. It just perpetuates it. But it has to tell the story that somehow we're getting rid of it. We're evolving. We're really not evolving. There's nothing to evolve. There's a dance taking place of activity and action. An interaction in spatial relationships that's constantly changing. It's impermanent, always shifting and changing, but we assume that it's going in the direction of getting rid of this feeling of guilt, this guilty feeling we have that we somehow slayed the prime creator, destroyed ourselves, destroyed reality, and we're very harmful. Okay, so this is what needs to be undone, this deception. It's all a deception. We haven't done anything to reality. But we did. We chose the idea of wanting to be prime creator, which necessitates us then falling into a dream of forgetfulness of what reality is. And assuming that reality's gone, it's been destroyed. I mean, that helps us forget, doesn't it? If we believe that reality is still exactly the way it's always been, then we would want to return to remembrance of it without question. So we have this belief that has been devastated, that we devastated it. And of course that breaks our heart. We feel so bad about that. We feel so guilty about it. And we feel, oh my gosh, we're really terrible. and we need to develop a new core. We haven't harmed reality in the slightest bit. It's just a story that we're telling ourselves. So we don't need any ego to orchestrate answers for us, to develop a new core, to advise us in how we can, how we're supposed to act and what we're supposed to do, the attitudes we're supposed to have. We don't need that at all. All we need to do is all we need to do is choose a new idea. The idea of not trying to be prime creator. That automatically we get the effect of non-negation from that. No guilt. And we see, nothing's being negated. Our experience is there's no negation taking place at all with this effect. And therefore we realize we're not harmful. Because we're experiencing non-negation. No harm. See, in existence right now, everything we see is being harmed. Everything is getting sick, is turning back to dust. And we're so worried about our actions. We don't want to harm people. You know, we don't want to do bad actions. But in this world, everything is vulnerable. So we have this feeling that we could do harm to others because everything is vulnerable here. So we have to try to learn to be very, very careful and cautious and nice, etc., so we don't do harm. But when we choose a new idea, the effect of that idea cannot be harmed. Nothing can touch it. So there's no feeling of being guilt, of being a bad person, of being potentially bad. No feeling like that whatsoever. Cannot harm anything. Cannot harm this effect. And that reminds us then of what we are. And we realize, hey, wait a minute. We are an effect of God, the Prime Creator. And therefore, we cannot be harmed at all. How can we be harmed? We can't harm the Prime Creator either because there's no such power to do that. But we need to be proof of that. And choosing the idea of not trying to be Prime Creator gives rise to this seamless effect of that cannot be negated, cannot be modified at all in any way. And this is proof to us that, therefore, we remember, what we are cannot be negated. Reality cannot be negated or modified in any way. So we're not guilty of any crimes. And therefore we don't need this vast scenario of purging ourselves from our harmful tendencies. See, the ego is in charge of existence. The ego thinks that it's God, is the ultimate advisor. The ego thinks it's going to teach us how to become perfect. And the ego believes that we need to purge ourselves of harmful tendencies. That we have some kind of innate harmfulness. And that we need to go through, that this world is a classroom. That we need to go through these lessons and learn all this stuff. This is all self-deception. This delusion. All we need to do is choose a new idea. And that will remind us of what we really are. You see, existence doesn't remind us of what we really are. It tells a lie about what we are. And then goes about curing this lie, curing what the lie says about us. It's like the ego says, well, we're really terrible and just totally destructive, but there's a way to get rid of, cure that destructivity eventually. We have to go through a long, painful process to do that. So the ego tells a lie about what we are and then sets about curing what we are. But it's a long, long, long process, supposedly. And so, when we come into this world, we a constellation of tendencies are swirling about us, and we're told that this is our self. This is what we are. We're a so-called person. And these tendencies are what we are, and these tendencies have to do with what we are. Now, those tendencies have to do with the persona. They have nothing to do with what we are. The ego's manufactured all of this existence, claiming that there's all of this is relevant to what we are, has zero relevance, None. But we become very focused and dutiful about all these tendencies that are swirling around in the world, that these psychological tendencies, and think that this has very great importance for us, and we need to follow along and see how these tendencies play out. Complete waste of time. This has nothing to do with what we are at all. Zero. It doesn't matter how these tendencies play out. There's no need to pay any attention to any of this at all. None. As evidenced by the great showcase touchstones, teachers like Ramana Maharshi, who simply said, abide in the self, abide in the overlay, abide in the vision of oneness. He's not the slightest bit interested in the play of consciousness, the play of tendencies, the play of psychology, the play of the persona, knowing that that has nothing to do with our true identity whatsoever. Nothing. Zero. Never will. And so it is possible, as we go along, to get a slight step back and to say, hey, wait a minute, this person, this persona I've been believing is crucial for my development. It has absolutely no relevance whatsoever. I don't need development. What I am doesn't need to be developed. It needs to be experienced. So here I have been paying all my attention to this swirl that I've called development, believing that there's something important taking place with this swirl of tendencies and attributes and characteristics, when in fact this has absolutely nothing to do with what I am right now. And I can choose to remember what I am by choosing a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and this will give me the experience of non-negation, non-modifiableness. And that'll really help me remember what I am, whereas the persona is nothing but forgetfulness of what I am. It's based on a false premise that I'm destructive, that what I am is destructive, not true. I chose an idea of destructivity, an idea of negation, but that doesn't make what I am capable of negation. You see, that's the thing. A dream of negation doesn't mean that one is capable of negation. We can dream that we're capable of harm and negation, but that doesn't mean that we really are. Life cannot harm itself. It's invulnerable. It has no capability to harm itself whatsoever. So as we look out upon all this harm, it's not life. It's a dream of life. It's a symbolic representation, but it's not the real thing. So symbols can seem to harm other symbols, but that's completely irrelevant to reality. We don't need to cure symbols or purge symbols of anything. Life is not guilty. We chose a dream of trying to destroy life, trying to destroy reality, trying to negate it. But that has done nothing to reality, hasn't touched it. So what are we guilty of? Nothing. We're guilty of folly. At best, we're guilty of a foolish whim, and that's it. How do you cure guilt over a foolish whim? You correct it by choosing a different idea. Plain and simple. The ego has no place in that. Characteristics, traits, qualities, attributes, actions have nothing to do with this. It's a choice. Choose a new idea cures the folly of choosing a foolish idea. It's the only cure there is. The only cure there is. The only one we need. And so it is possible, I've seen that, it is possible to follow the advice of the great teachers. Drop the I. Drop the persona. Drop this so-called development. Because that is the path of delusion. It is possible. and this teaching here is moving toward that, pointing toward that, because I was able to experience that, to see it, saw the full context of the delusion. And just right in everyday functioning here, I was able to pay attention to it and say, yeah, just dissolve. Let the persona, the personality, just dissolve. Let all the tendencies just go their ways. No need to have a constellation of any tendencies at all, any characteristics, qualities at all. Because the only thing we're looking for is the experience of non-modification. That's the only thing we need here. Don't need to experience any sort of qualities or characteristics or tendencies whatsoever. So the tight constellation of this that we call a persona is held by our attention and our focus on it. All that can simply drift off and dissipate like fog burning off. Don't need to see it. Don't need to experience it. Don't need to be aware of any of it. Don't need to attract any of it. We don't need to work on anything. We only need to experience the effect of non-modification, that which is cannot be modified. And just experience that. That is it. Don't need to experience a person with a name. We don't need to say anymore, I am such and such. And in fact, we'll laugh at that. Ridiculous. So it is possible to see this. It is possible to glimpse it. Just a couple days ago, I glimpsed it very clearly. And that's the big prize. I mean, that's getting to the big prize. So when we're paying attention and studying, contemplating, paying attention to these videos and other videos, and we think, are we getting anywhere? The answer is yes. But the person is not getting anywhere. Okay? This is the all-important distinction. As long as we're looking at the persona and the qualities, characteristics, and traits and activities of the persona, everything that makes up what we call the persona, we'll keep thinking that we're not getting anywhere. We're missing something. Why? How come we're not getting anywhere? But the moment we see that the persona has no utility to us whatsoever, it's based on a false premise of harmfulness and the guilt that gives rise to, and that we don't need this guilt trip at all, we can completely abandon the guilt trip and choose a new idea and experience non-modification. The moment we see that, glimpse it, then we realize, hey, we really have been making fantastic progress, tremendous progress. We just didn't see it because we're looking for it to show up in some place that it can't show up. We're looking for it to show up in the persona, the person, the personality. We're looking to see the progress there, where all along the progress was to see that we don't need to make any personal progress. And then in glimpsing that, we say, oh my gosh, we're almost there. We're almost there. Again, we thought that the spiritual path was to make some kind of personal progress, and so we're looking for it, and we see the personality is just as messed up as it's ever been. You know, our dreams are still crazy and chaotic like always, and we don't think we've really changed at all. Our personality is pretty much exactly the same. We have all the same troubles and neuroses and insecurities, instabilities, dislikes, and etc. We're the same. Really haven't changed at all. And we think, gosh, it's all been a waste of time, this spiritual path. And then one day we glimpse and we see that guilt is completely bogus. We don't need to go on the guilt trip at all. We don't need the personality. We don't need development. We don't need change. We don't need to change anything about the personality. We just need to let it go. And that's when we see we have made the progress. We've done what needed to be done. So that is why I'm saying to you, it's so crucial to have touchstones. Those who have attained, high teachers, mid-level teachers, to keep pointing out that you're making progress. You're just looking for the progress to show up in a place where it doesn't show up. It doesn't show up in the persona. It shows up in getting clarity that you don't need the persona. You don't need a persona. No one needs a persona. There's no need for a persona. There's no need to identify with a personality at all. Personality is just a tool. You don't need to use the tool. You just set the tool down. You don't need to attack the tool. You just say, I don't need that tool. I don't need to build anything. I don't need to build a person. I don't need to build a new self. I don't need to build a new creation, a new reality. All I have to do is experience an effect of the effect of non-modification, which reminds me of reality, of what I am. That's what I need to do. And of course, this world won't give me that. So I need to choose a new idea that overlays this world, an effect that overlays this world, so I can have continuity. See, the importance of the overlay is it gives us continuity. We still remain in this world with all the spatial relationships. It's just that we are now experiencing non-modification. So even though the dance of existence of modification is ceaselessly dancing, its dance of modification, we're not paying any attention to that, and it has no importance. It's still there. It's like a shadow. When we go about our day, we're not paying attention to shadows, are we? Not at all. And yet they're there. So we walk along a street and the sun is shining, our shadow is moving with us, but we're not paying attention to that. Most of us pay zero attention to shadows as we're going about the day. Well, just like that, existence, this dance of modification, this dream scenario of modification, will still be there, and yet we'll attach no importance to it. Functionally, we use it to navigate spatial relationships. But we place no importance. It has no relevance or meaning. None. Just like a shadow has no meaning for us as we're walking down a street, as we're driving our car, the shadow the car is casting has no relevance to us whatsoever. Same thing. As we go about in spatial relationships in this world, those spatial relationships have no importance to us whatsoever. What we're experiencing now is non-modification, an effect that is not being modified, and that does have relevance to us because it's reminding us of what we are, which is spirit, which is the extension of the mind of God, the prime creator. So all of this ties together, all this teaching, and the direction that it's leading us in, it'll eventually will be glimpsed, and then you will say, aha, this is important, this is relevant. This is pointing to the answer. It's not pointing towards modification of the personality. The personality is like a vehicle that we've been driving that we think is going to get us somewhere, but this vehicle doesn't get us anywhere. It's a vehicle that's supposedly driving away from guilt, trying to find a land that's free of guilt. But the only way to be free of guilt is to experience the effect of non-modification. And then we realize, aha, you see, it was only an idea of modification that I chose. And by choosing idea of non-modification, I remember what I am, which cannot be modified. And since what I am cannot be modified, and since I know that I was created by the Prime Creator, and since I can't be modified, that means the Prime Creator cannot be modified either. And all of reality cannot be modified. I realize it's impossible to have guilt. There's no basis for it. I can't harm anything. What is real cannot be harmed. If what is real cannot be modified, therefore, it cannot be harmed. It's impossible. Therefore, it's impossible to have any guilt. And therefore, I don't need a vehicle to drive away from guilt to try into some place, some country, some place where nothing, you know, where free of guilt. The personality is like a rickety car. Terrible car. It's always breaking down. We're breathing its exhaust. It's noisy. It's a bumpy ride. Horrible. We simply don't need to drive that vehicle anymore. We drive the vehicle of non-modification. It's completely smooth and serene, stable, beautiful drive. It's like a roll, driving in a Rolls Royce. And we get that simply by choosing a new idea, not by doing anything, not by accomplishing anything, not by modifying our personality. I said, we get it by choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator. So, with that said, and with that focus on this day, this Mother's Day, I need to now take my mom out for brunch. So let's wrap up this video, but I will return at some point very soon and shed much greater light on all of this. Okay, very great. That's it.